Before.
Others. They'll come for me. I am number four.
Love the light up gimmicks. Hi, everybody. I'm Mercy.
And I'm Crandall.
And welcome to Armchair Directors. As you can tell from the light up palm gimmicks, we are doing Iron Man 3.
If only.
Yeah. We're doing I Am Number 4, which turned out to be a big steaming number 2.
AKA I Am Flashlight Hands. That's pretty much what I would be referring to this movie as from now on.
Mm-hmm. So we got to see an advanced screening tonight in Waterloo. Movie's not due out for another week and a half. Mm-hmm. And we were very excited about it, and we are no longer very excited about it, and we are here to warn you not to be excited about it either.
On paper, it does sound sort of like a slam dunk. You know, it's this sci-fi-tinged action romance from director DJ Caruso, who has made dumb scripts good in the past with stuff like Disturbia, even Eagle Eye, which was idiotic but entertaining.
Shia-tastic.
Yep. And now, he's taken this movie produced by Michael Bay, and it's just not very good.
Okay, I got tricked by the Michael Bay thing, because when his name flashes up on the trailer produced by Michael Bay, for some reason my brain goes, ooh, Michael Bay, and it doesn't realize that...
Michael Bay!
90% of the Michael Bay movies I've seen have been garbage. So this you can add to the garbage pile. It really all boils down to the script.
So the script really does let this movie down. It was written by the two guys who created and wrote Smallville for the first 6 years, and Marty Noxon, who worked on the Buffy show, you know, and basically it's sort of a melding of those two without the clever wit of Buffy. So yes, you know, Freak of the Week, terrible Smallville episodes sort of make this thing look good because the dialogue is dumb.
Yeah.
The special effects are passable at best, which is sort of Smallville-tastic.
Yeah.
The bad guys are...
horrible.
Really poorly executed. Awful. There's nothing menacing about them.
Really
over
the top. They're
just kind of dumb.
Really over the top, silly. They're trying to go for something.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what they were going for, but whatever it was, they didn't achieve it.
And number four, Alex Pettifer, you know, didn't strike me as being all that charismatic. He's all right. You know, he's got that look.
Yeah, yeah.
That classical look. But he has nothing to do. And we're supposed to just care for him because he's the star of the movie. But he doesn't do anything in the movie that endears me to him and makes me start to root for him or this alien species.
Yeah, that's the other thing. I mean, the movie really, it starts off great, going a million miles an hour with... a bunch of people getting attacked, and mm-hmm. it really grabs you by the throat right away.
It does start off promisingly.
And then the brakes get slammed on it, and it goes into kind of like a bad teen drama.
Teen movie mode.
And then this exposition, this narration comes out of nowhere while number four, is driving on the road, and this horrible, horrible narration comes in. Explaining everything.
Mm-hmm.
Like, because I've got all these questions. Like, what's this light-up gimmick on his hand and on his leg? And who are these crazy, evil-looking dudes? And
yeah.
And just all spoiled in a really crappy overhead shot with narration going, I'm an alien. I'm from another planet. And this happened to this guy and that guy, and I'm the fourth guy, and pretty much spoiling the movie in the first 15 minutes.
And the main problem with that, you know, okay, if you want to just dump all this exposition on us, at least if it's interesting somehow or there's stakes to it, I might get invested. But in this, they're like, we're aliens. These other aliens want to kill us because they want to come to Earth and take over Earth. But the other aliens are morons, so I never thought that they actually had a chance of taking over Earth.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why his brand of alien – you know,
why are
deserves
they the hero?
To be saved. Why are they special?
Yeah.
So the whole time, it's just a big,
who cares? It's like, it's this alien race that has this conflict, and I have no reason to care for one side or the other.
Now, you know, they can flash lights in our face all they want to try and dazzle us with the cool factor. And, you know, the special effects in some of these scenes are kind of cool that you're like, oh, that's kind of neat. You know, he's lighting up this old house with his flashlight hands.
It's really dark in here.
But that cool factor wears off really fast when there's nothing else happening in the movie. Yeah. And I love that, you know, when it goes into teen movie mode, there's the jocks and the outcast, and everybody is just sort of playing their cardboard cutout role. And then they keep trying to throw in these little character backstory moments that really hold no weight to the story, like the nerd whose stepfather is mean to him.
Yeah.
And so are the bullies at school, and don't we feel sorry for him? Not really.
No,
you know,
not at all.
The actors certainly don't do anything to help that either.
No. Time for best part.
Worst part.
Best part.
Best part.
Best part.
Best part.
Would have to be the cast.
I gotta go with the tank sequence.
The special effects.
The final 10 minutes of the movie.
Man in suit.
Man in suit! So that's the best part.
Worst part.
Worst part.
Worst part.
Worst part.
Love story with Jessica Biel.
Cheap sounding canned.
Michelle Rodriguez.
Jennifer Aniston.
The entire movie. Go ahead.
I can't in clear conscience call anything in this movie the best part.
Yeah.
Because even something that's better than everything else is still awful. So I can't pick one. Like maybe if this was a 5-hour show, I'd be able to find a little nugget.
Right.
Not on a 30-minute show. Worst part is the writing. The writing, it's so awful. Halfway through, I wanted to put in my earbuds for my iPod, but I was worried about they've got these security guys making sure no one's recording the show, and I didn't want someone thinking I had a recording device or anything like that. So I endured it. But really, it's kind of, I relate it to someone talking to someone with really bad breath. All right. So you're talking to this guy and he's got this horrible breath and you don't care what he has to say next. All you can think about is, it's going to hit me again. Oh, the bad breath. Watching these actors, their mouths, it was the same feeling like, oh no, more bad dialogue. Oh, more bad dialogue. I say, shame on the scriptwriter for writing such a horrible script. Shame on the director for accepting such horrible performances. And shame on the actors for not speaking up and going, hey man, you can write this stuff, but you can't say it.
Yeah. Now, I'm going to go worst part, you know, the talent that was squandered here. Because, like I said, DJ Caruso in the past has turned kind of okay scripts and crappy movies into very slick entertainment that works. This doesn't. And there are people in this movie that I like Timothy Oliphant, who on TV is awesome. Deadwood, one of my favorite shows ever. He is great. He's on a great show right now called Justified. He's awesome.
Yeah.
And he's got nothing to do. And just...
No actor looks cringe. More like... No actor today working in Hollywood looks more like Michael Biehn.
Yeah. That is pretty high praise, I guess. So I guess, you know, tying into that, you know, the script is bad. It feels like a Twilight knockoff. They're trying to just do a more sci-fi tinged Twilight. Yeah. And even little things like the music in this movie bugged me. It sounds like somebody grabbed my iPod and said, what's the hits on this from these, you know, sort of street cred bands like Kings of Leon, the Black Keys, Jimmy World, and they picked like their hits and just sampled them through the movie. And I just kept rolling my eyes every time one of these hit songs just came up because they're trying to be cool and hip by getting these cool bands. But just throwing them in where they don't work doesn't make your movie cool or hip.
Yeah, totally. Now, totally felt like a weekly teen drama.
The best part, I would say, is Teresa Palmer's number 6. Now, her acting isn't particularly good, but number 6 gets to kick a lot of butt in this movie. She's very hot. And her going around acting all Buffy-like, I thought that was cool. You know, she gets some good action scenes. She stakes a bunch of people. And even though there's a creature that's basically Raptor meets Rancor, you know, I still thought some of the action scenes were at least entertaining enough that if it's on TV, you might want to check it out.
I couldn't understand a word she said, though.
Her accent really didn't help.
And there was one John McClane type of one-liner catchphrase in particular that her accent butchered.
I didn't hear what that line was either, and people in the theater were laughing, and I thought, what did she just say?
Yeah. All right, so from one preview to a couple more, little teasers aired during the Super Bowl this past weekend. Transformers 3, Captain America.
Yep.
And the third
Super
one.
Super 8.
Super 8. So we'll be right back with a look at those previews.